Hi, I'm Vance, and welcome to Repair and Replace. If your refrigerator has power, the lights work, but the compressor isn't starting, then it could be one of several problems. If you can hear the fans running and the compressor is warm, then it's most likely an issue with the compressor or the starting components. This is what we'll be exploring in this episode. On the other hand, if none of the fans are working, then it's most likely an issue with the cold control, defrost control, thermistor, or the control board. You can see how to troubleshoot this in the video linked below. In this episode, first we'll learn how it all works. Then we'll test each component with a multimeter. This applies to most top freezer, bottom freezer, and side-by-side refrigerators. All refrigerators work in the same basic way. When cooling is needed, the cold control sends power to the cooling circuit. The compressor pushes the refrigerant through the system. In the freezer, heat is extracted by the evaporator coils and is released through the condenser coils behind the refrigerator. This process continues until the set temperature is reached. The compressor uses a single-phase motor. It has a start winding and a run winding, which are both connected to a common terminal. Attached is an overload protector that disconnects power if the current or temperature gets too high. Single-phase motors use resistance or a capacitor to create a phase shift in the start winding. This rotating magnetic field creates the torque needed to start the motor. Many refrigerators use a relay with a PTC thermistor. This heat-sensitive resistor acts like a switch. As the motor starts, the thermistor heats up and disconnects power to the start winding. This prevents it from overheating. Other models also use a run capacitor to help increase the efficiency. This run capacitor allows the start winding to stay energized as the motor runs. Older fridges might use a start capacitor, which is taken out of the circuit by the relay shortly after startup. Keep in mind that these are the most common components, but there are other setups as well. This includes current sensing relays or combination relays and kits. Regardless of the model, a faulty motor winding, a bad overload, relay, or capacitor can all prevent the compressor from starting. Using a multimeter, components can be tested for continuity. A continuity test will determine if there is a continuous path for electricity to flow through. Without continuity, the component will not work and will need to be replaced. To begin, you might need a screwdriver or nut driver and a multimeter. Keep in mind there is some variation between models, and not all refrigerators will have the same parts. You can enter your model number on the AIM Resupply website to see a parts breakdown. This can be helpful to show you which parts are in your refrigerator and where they are located. First, slide the refrigerator out from the wall. When there is enough room, unplug the cord to disconnect the power. In some models, you might need to remove the water supply line to gain access to the back. Close the shutoff valve to turn off the water supply. Next, use an adjustable wrench to loosen and remove the supply line. Let any remaining water drain into a plastic container. Now, slide the fridge all the way out so you have plenty of room to work. On the back of the refrigerator is an access panel. Use a 1/4-inch nut driver to remove the screws. Now simply lift up to remove the panel. When accessing the compressor components, it's best to wear cut-resistant gloves. In some models, you'll have to remove a cover. The capacitor stores and releases an electrical charge, so be careful of any exposed terminals as it can still give a shock. Before anything else, use a high ohm resistor or a screwdriver with an insulated handle. Touch between the two terminals to release any stored energy inside the capacitor. Now take a picture of the wires for reference. Next, remove the start relay and capacitor. Now disconnect the wires. In other models, the capacitor will be mounted directly on the relay. In this case, you'll have to remove the retaining clip. Next, remove the capacitor and relay. Now, separate the capacitor from the relay. Finally, discharge the capacitor. On the compressor, you'll see three terminals in either an upward or downward orientation. There's one terminal for the common, one for the start winding, and another for the run winding. While you're here, it's best to test the motor windings to see if it's failed electrically. Set your multimeter to the ohms or resistance setting. First, test the bottom two terminals. This is testing the start and run windings together. You should get a reading of around 10 ohms. Now, test between the start winding and common. You should get a reading around 6 ohms. Next, test between the run winding and common. This will have the lowest resistance at around 4 ohms. Your resistance readings may be a little different, but the two lowest values will add up to the largest value. If there is no resistance in any of the tests, then the compressor has failed and will need to be replaced. You can also test the compressor for short. Test between each terminal to any bare metal on the compressor. Keep in mind this won't work on a painted surface, so you'll likely have to find the ground wire or one of the copper pipes. If there is resistance, then the windings are shorted to ground. Another thing to check is if the terminals are blackened with carbon, as this may prevent a good connection with the starter. You can use steel wool, an emery cloth, or sandpaper to clean the terminals. If the test shows that the compressor is faulty, then you'll need to call a technician. Since this is a sealed system with refrigerant gases, it can't be accessed without the proper tools and training. Now, if the compressor is good, then move on to testing the start devices. The overload protector is connected to the common terminal on the compressor. Depending on the model, it will either be a separate component or will be built into the relay. In any case, it's best to test for continuity. Set your multimeter to the ohms or resistance setting. Now touch the probes to each terminal. You should get a reading between 0 and 1 ohm. This is continuity. If you have a combination starter, then test between the top two terminals. If there's no continuity or if the resistance is significantly off, then the overload protector has failed and will need to be replaced. Now, if you have a combination relay, then you'll have to replace the entire part. The start relay will either be a PTC thermistor or a current start relay. A PTC thermistor is a heat-sensitive resistor. As current flows through, the thermistor heats up and the resistance increases. When it's warm, the thermistor disconnects the start winding. This is why it takes a few minutes to cool down before you can restart your fridge. You can test the PTC relay for resistance. Simply test between the R and S terminals, which might be labeled 5 and 6. The resistance should be between 3 to 12 ohms at room temperature. If there is no resistance and no continuity, or if the resistance is extremely high, then the relay has failed and will need to be replaced. To test the combination relay, the steps are the same. Simply test between the two terminals on the back. Some newer style relays use a small circuit board. These can't be easily tested, but you can still check for burn marks or any visible damage. A current start relay works differently. When current flows through the coil, the magnetic field pulls a plunger and closes the circuit. The current drops shortly after startup, which releases the plunger and disconnects the start winding. For this relay, you'll need to do two continuity tests. First, test between the M terminal and the free terminal. There should be continuity. Now, test between the S and the free terminal. When the relay is facing down, there should be no continuity. When you flip it over, the contacts will close and there should be continuity. If it fails either test, then replace the relay. On the side of the capacitor, you'll see the capacitance rating in microfarads. This is what we'll be referencing. Set your multimeter to the capacitance setting. Now test between both terminals and wait 5 seconds. The reading should be within 10% of the rated value. If there is no reading and no continuity, or the capacitance is outside of this range, then the capacitor is faulty and should be replaced. When matching a capacitor, make sure that the microfarad rating is the same. This will ensure that the compressor works properly. Some refrigerators won't have a starting relay or a capacitor. Instead, these models use an inverter control board. This is usually a large gray box either mounted on the compressor or off to the side. These are used with variable speed compressors. The board will adjust the power as needed. Inverter boards can't be tested, so it's best to eliminate all other problems before installing a new one. You can learn more in the video linked below. If your capacitor is separate from the start relay, then connect it to the two terminals. Now reconnect the wires. If needed, align the relay and overload protector. If your capacitor attaches to the combination relay, then align the mounting pin and push it into place. Next, align the relay and attach it to the compressor. Now, attach the retaining clip. Finally, reconnect the wires. Align the back panel onto the mounting tabs. Now, tighten the screws. Reconnect the water supply and tighten the connection. Open the shutoff valve. Plug in the cord to reconnect the power. Now slide it back into place. Make sure to leave a couple of inches of space between the refrigerator and the wall. This will allow for proper airflow. Now test the refrigerator to see if it's working properly. If you like this and want to see more tutorials and informational videos, then subscribe to our channel. And if you need help, you can call or visit an Amory location to talk with our knowledgeable staff. Thanks for watching.